Acts chapter 4 is where we are this morning with the mission. We're continuing to look at the early church of Jesus Christ, this church that Jesus promised the gates of hell would not prevail against it. And as we look this morning at the text, and really all the way up to chapter 4, we've seen those words coming true, that here is the Spirit-empowered church. From the very beginning of the book of Acts, we find Christ saying that he would ascend into heaven, but they were to be his witnesses. They would be left here to make a difference for the kingdom of God, a difference for eternity, and that the Spirit of God, they were to do nothing until the Spirit of God fell upon them. Once the Spirit fell, you remember, people thought maybe the disciples were drunk, but Simon Peter stood and he preached and he said, listen, they're not drunk, they're filled with the Spirit as the prophet said it would be. And he preached the first message there at Pentecost. A few days later, they were walking around the temple grounds, and if you remember, the disciples came upon a man who was lame from birth. 40-something years had passed in this man's life, and he didn't know what it was to walk, to run, to jump. He never had a chance as a child to play even one day the way all the other children had. And yet this man found himself destitute because of his sickness, because of this disease that had robbed him of his legs. And he stood every day, he sat as he did every day, begging for just enough money that he might be able to get by just another day. And he met the disciples that day. And when he asked them for money, they said those words that changed his life forever. Silver and gold we have not, but what we do have we share with you. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, get up and walk. This man jumped up, if you remember, and he began to celebrate, and he began to worship. And you can imagine the stir that was caused. It said that everyone was amazed, and they were astonished by what had happened. They looked at this man, and they said, this is the man that sat here every single day. He could never walk, and yet here he is walking. And in that moment, Simon Peter stood and gave the second message that we have in the book of Acts, the second sermon. And he told them on that day that those people, that if they would repent and they would believe on Jesus Christ for salvation, that times of refreshing would come. Everything looks like it's going so well. But when you get to chapter 4, you come across the very thing that Jesus said would happen. Sometimes I wonder, did they forget in the first days of the Spirit of God falling upon them and filling them, and they were seeing such success? Did they forget the words of Jesus, I wonder, when he told them, just as they hated me, guess what? They will hate you. And just as they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If you remember, there were times in Luke 12 and Luke chapter 21, times when Jesus would remind the disciples, there's a day coming when you will be dragged before kings. You'll be dragged into synagogues. You'll be put before rulers, and you'll have to give an account for the hope and for the faith that is within you. And he would remind them that in that moment, they didn't need to worry, because the Spirit of God would give them utterance, would give them wisdom in what to say. That in that moment, they would have the opportunity to give testimony. Well, the words of Jesus are about to come true. The first persecution of the church of Jesus Christ is about to take place. And I want you to remember, this is not an isolated incident. This is not something that would happen once, it would go away. For the next 300 years, the church of Jesus Christ would suffer for proclaiming the truth of God, for preaching salvation. On this day, these men will have to stand before the rulers and the authorities and give an account for simply doing a good deed. They're going to be arrested. You know why? For healing someone. Isn't that a crazy, messed up world? But you're going to find it was more than just because they healed. It was because of the name in which they healed. It was because of the message that they would continue to preach. And throughout the history of the church, even unto this day, listen, hundreds of thousands of Christians around the world, every year. Let me say that again. hundreds of thousands of Christians every year are killed because they proclaim faith in Jesus Christ. In the first three centuries alone, men, women, children would be tossed into arenas to be killed by wild animals. Jesus would not be the last to be crucified. Simon Peter himself would be crucified upside down, not wanting to be crucified in the same way that Jesus was. Men would be beheaded. Men would be basically strapped to poles and lit on fire for the Roman courts so they could have light. The atrocities and the horror that has happened to the early church of Jesus Christ. You see, the moment that they probably have been able to put in the back of their heads and were likely trying to forget about was suddenly beginning to start in Acts chapter 4. And what they found is that whenever and wherever you truly and boldly speak the truth of God, you will always meet resistance and persecution. It doesn't take long. So what would these men do? What does this story tell us? Four things this morning that I want us to see. When you pick up in chapter 4, verse 1 with me, it says, as they were speaking. You have to understand and remember who the they were. This is about chapter 3 as much as it is chapter 4. The they are Simon Peter and the Apostle John. These two men were proclaiming the truth of God. These two men were preaching. Simon Peter finished up his sermon, and apparently John is now speaking. The crowds had formed. The crowds had gathered. Listen, literally in the place that they were standing at the Gate Beautiful, there could have been thousands upon thousands of people. And I can assure you that that is the case, because by the end of this chapter, we're going to find that another 5,000 men, not counting children, not counting women, had come to faith in Jesus Christ. Imagine how many people must have been listening. The crowd that was there on that day, anyone in Jerusalem was hearing. It was a buzz about the man who had been healed and the message that was being proclaimed. You couldn't get away from it. Everybody heard. Everybody knew what was going on down at the temple. And as these two men were speaking to the people, it says that the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came upon them. That's not a good thing. These names ought to be reminiscent of the people that did the most atrocious thing just a few months ago. These are the men, the high priest, Annas, who was the ex-high priest, but apparently still controlled the priesthood, even though he wasn't the high priest. His son-in-law, Caiaphas, had been placed into the priesthood. He was the reigning high priest at this moment, though Annas was probably the one still in control, pulling the strings. These two men, their names ought to be familiar to you, because these were the very men that had Jesus Christ crucified. We forget that only months have passed since the end of the book of Luke. Everyone remembers well Jesus on the cross. The temple guard was probably the second most authoritative, powerful person in all of Jerusalem. He was like the head police officer for the temple. Of course, when the crowd started to get unruly, of course, when the crowd started to gather, he would, of course, be there to see what is it that is happening. So you've got the police chief there. You've got the high priests, numerous ones of them there. You've got the Sadducees. You say, who are the Sadducees? Well, you had several ruling parties within Jerusalem. Many of them made up what we call the Sanhedrin, what was known in the scripture as and known as the Sanhedrin. 72 men, priests, rulers, elders, ex-priests, Sadducees, Pharisees. The Sadducees, they were really the ruling class out of all the people that we mentioned. Out of the Sadducees came the high priests, came the priests. The Sadducees were wealthy aristocrats. They were the landowners. These were the men who were the movers and shakers. They basically made up the legislative branch as well as the judicial branch of everything that happened in the kingdom of Israel. These were men that were close and had close ties to the Roman government. These were the men that when the Roman government needed to get their people under control, they turned to these men to make it happen. These men had very soft, cushy lives because they were basically puppets of the Roman government. It was important to them that there be no other uprising like what happened with Jesus. First thing I want you to see is what we find in this first verse. In the second verse, in the third verse, that these men were simply taken for teaching. These men are going to be arrested for healing and for teaching. It says that these men, we explained who they are, being greatly disturbed in verse 2, that means they're hot, they're ticked. They're upset. What were they upset about? Well, there were several reasons why they were disturbed. First and foremost, they're looking at Simon Peter and they're looking at John and they know exactly who they are. These are followers of who? Jesus. And we thought we put Jesus to rest. We crucified him. We stopped this teaching by crucifying the master. If you remember in that moment, the disciples scattered. They were nowhere to be found. John was the only one even standing there at the cross. The rest of them had forsaken Christ, denied Christ, walked away from Christ. And as far as they were considered, these men, there was nothing left to be done to them because they were scared. They were useless. They thought they chopped the head of the snake off and thought, you know what, then it's going to die. And with Jesus, surely it died, but they had a problem because the same Jesus that died and they put in the ground, guess what? 3 days later, he rose. And they couldn't deny it. If you remember, these are the men, the high priests and others, these are the men that paid off the guards to say, well, you know what? Someone came and stole the body of Jesus. They knew that wasn't true. The guards' testimony was, listen, these angels showed up, we passed out, and listen, Jesus was alive. He came out of the tomb. Nobody took him, but they were paid to say what? Somebody took him. Hundreds witnessed Jesus preaching and teaching the kingdom, his resurrected body. He was seen. The evidence was overwhelming, but you know what? Men, ladies, can I get a witness? Sometimes men don't want to say they're wrong, right? That was your chance, ladies. That was so weak. I thought I would get a... Hey, there you go. I knew Aaron would have one. And here it is, rearing its ugly head again. They were mad because they thought, who are these men to preach? Who are these men to teach? The Sadducees were none too happy because they were the priests. It was their job to teach. It was their job to preach. And here are these unlearned men, and they were looking at them saying, you have no right to teach here. Who are you? Who do you think you are? It's the same thing that the church has asked today. Who do you think you are to preach Jesus? Who do you think you are to come into a workplace and to share your faith, to come into a community and share your faith? Who do you think you are to say that Jesus is the only way? And these men were questioned. They were disturbed because they thought you weren't taught by the best teachers in Jerusalem. You have no place here. Problem was, the crowds didn't feel the same way, did they? The other thing that made the Sadducees so upset, look at what it says they were teaching. It's not just that they were disturbed that they were teaching, but he specifies and he says, because they were teaching the people and they were proclaiming that in Jesus there was what? There was resurrection from the dead. You see, the Sadducees, how they were separated from the Pharisees, you hear these two names in the New Testament. The Sadducees were the ones that, they were the liberal theologians. They didn't believe that there was an actual physical, bodily resurrection from the dead. That's what they had taught from the beginning. And now here are these men, not only teaching, though in their mind they were unfit to teach, they are teaching something that goes directly against what it is that they want to believe. And they're threatened. And rather than listening to the truth and to the evidence, they immediately resist and reject what the messengers have to say. They are furious because they are teaching that Jesus Christ can raise a person from the dead. And thirdly, what really upset them and disturbed them was the Roman government looked at them and expected them to keep control. And as they looked out over the temple, what did they see? To them, it looked like things were about to get out of control. To them, it looked like here are thousands of people that are starting to follow the way. They're starting to follow Jesus Christ. They're saying that he indeed is the Messiah. And if that's true, then the whole religious establishment just killed the Son of God, just killed the Messiah. They weren't willing to face that truth. They weren't willing to face the Roman government with the fact that maybe there is this uprising. And so they felt very threatened because their livelihood was at stake, their power was at stake, their prominence was at stake. And for all those reasons, it says they were greatly disturbed. And they confronted Peter. And they confronted John. And they were taken and arrested for teaching about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. What they didn't know was they couldn't stop what God was doing. You see, sometimes I think the church even forgets this very simple statement by Jesus that the gates of hell will not prevail against the advancing church of Jesus Christ. Do you hear that? We think to ourselves, but you know what? If this election doesn't go right, what's going to happen to the church? Nothing. It will keep advancing the way that it always has. Kingdoms come, and guess what? Kingdoms go. Presidents come, and guess what? Presidents go. Do you realize God is in control even when you think he's not? Do you realize that God is not threatened, that God is not thwarted, that God is not somehow cast off his throne because an election doesn't go the way we think it should? Well, let me remind you, our hope is never in an election. Our hope is in Christ. He is the truth that nothing can alter. What he says will be. What he says is coming, is coming. The truth is the truth is the truth. And no man, no government, no politics can ever undo what it is that God has spoken. God steers. Do you realize that? That God steers history. He's not up there wringing his hands, wondering how he's going to put America back together. They can't stop what God is doing. In fact, that's probably what infuriated them, was that it goes on and says, they laid hands on them. They put them in jail till the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the message, guess what happened? They believed what they were trying to stop, they can't stop. And in that one day, 5,000. Think about that. 10 times more people than will be on this campus right now. 5,000. That's almost the size of Wendell, people. And what? That's church growth. That's multiplication. That's God stepping in and doing something so big that you can't really explain it in a moment. I mean, that's what Jesus meant when he said, I'm going to do greater things. You haven't seen it all. Through you, there are greater things coming. In one day, 5,000 men, that's not the women, that's not the children, that's none of that, that's just the men. And what these men were trying to stop, you know what they were starting to realize? There's no stopping it. They're going to realize it soon enough. There's no stopping it. These men, when they approach these disciples, they are anxious, they are upset, they want to put to rest this Jesus thing. But they can't. In 2,000 years of trying, guess what? They can't. And every day that Jesus tarries, you know what we'll find? Is the world can't overcome the church. Not only were they taken for teaching, but secondly, we find they were turned over for trial. You find that they were arrested. They were turned over for trial. The next day, the reason they were held overnight was they at least gave the disciples what they didn't give to Jesus. The reason Jesus was wrongly, basically condemned was they weren't allowed to have court in the evening. Everybody had to be there in the Sanhedrin. If you remember with Jesus, they threw together a kangaroo court overnight. He was basically judged and condemned before the sun ever came up the next day. And by that moment, it was really too late. They had already passed judgment wrongfully against Jesus and falsely accused Jesus and condemned him to die. The disciples, they arrested and they did what they should have done with Jesus. They waited till the next day and then they held court. I want you to put yourself in the position of these disciples. Could you imagine what it would have been like to have been turned over for trial in this moment? If you look at the scripture, he literally says, on the next day, they had to stand before, listen to this, rulers, elders, scribes, that means Pharisees, Sadducees, priests, elders among the Jews, and it says they were all gathered there in Jerusalem, and it says, and here is Annas, the high priest. Not the active high priest, the ex-high priest, but this is the man that had Jesus condemned. Caiaphas, his son-in-law, the man who had Jesus condemned to death. Some guy that really history tells us nothing about, John and Alexander, we assume they were priests. And all the other high priests, those of high priestly descent, when they had placed them in the center, so here they are, the way the court would have been set up, and the Sanhedrin met, they met almost in a circle, but it was really a semicircle, and they would place the person who had to give testimony and witness right in the center of them all. So they're basically standing, and they're surrounded by those who are going to judge them. You think they were intimidated in that moment? Put yourself in their position. These people have real power. If these people have the power, now understand, they couldn't condemn you to death, but if they want to beat you, they can. If they want to scourge you, they can. If they want to imprison you forever, they can. The only thing they can't do is kill you, but if they want to take you to the government, the Roman government, and have you killed, they can probably do it. How do they know that? Because they just did it with Jesus. And plop these two men and think about, I mean, here is Simon Peter. 2 months ago, he's denying Jesus. 2 months ago, he's got a little girl in front of him saying, aren't you one of those guys that hung out with Jesus? And what is he doing? He's flipping out. He's saying, no, that ain't me. And then when she won't let it go, he starts cussing at her. That's Simon Peter. The guy who was scared of the little girl, now suddenly he's standing before rulers and elders and scribes, priests, people who literally hold life. But what we find here is this is not the same Simon Peter. You know why? Because he has the Holy Spirit of God in him now. When you have the Holy Spirit of God, it makes all the difference in the world. Because in this moment, we're going to find the words of Luke true that I spoke to you about a few minutes ago. When you look at Luke chapter 12 and you see in Luke chapter 12, verse 11 through 12, these words of Jesus that he gave to his disciples, hopefully these things came right to their mind as they remembered what Jesus says. Jesus said to them in chapter 12, when they bring you before the synagogues and the rulers and the authorities, don't worry about how or what you're going to speak in your defense or what it is that you're going to say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. Jesus would mention again to them in Luke chapter 21 a very similar statement. He would say to them in Luke chapter 21, but before all these things in verse 12, they will lay their hands on you and they will persecute you, delivering you to the synagogues, delivering you to prisons, bringing you before kings and governors for my name's sake, and it will lead to an opportunity. Think about that. You're going to be arrested. You're going to be put before these rulers. And it's not for no reason. He says it will be an opportunity for you to give testimony. So make up your minds. Now think of this is backwards from the way we think. He says, so make up your minds. Decide today is what he's saying. Listen to this. This is so strange. Not to prepare beforehand. Most of us think, if I'm going to witness, what do I have to do? I mean, why don't we witness? Well, because I'm not prepared. Well, why don't we witness? Because I don't know what it is I'm going to say. If I was more prepared, I would be a better witness. What does Jesus say right here? He says, why are you worried about being prepared beforehand? You know me. You've walked with me. You've been discipled. In that moment, listen to what he says. I will give you utterance and wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to resist or refute. Where does the boldness come from? The Holy Spirit of God. We need to be filled with the Spirit if we're going to effectively witness. And if we're going to be filled with the Spirit of God, then you know what you need to be, church? There's a couple things. Number one, you need to be clean. God is in the business of using broken, chipped vessels. That's what all of us are. We all come to Him broken and chipped, right? And the reality is, most of you, if I handed you a piece of china that was broken or chipped, you'd probably still drink out of it, wouldn't you? But what if I handed you a piece of china that was filthy? Is there a difference? Yeah. And what He desires of us is to humbly follow Him, to live righteous lives, to put ourselves in a place where He can fill us and use us, to set aside our will and to pick up His will, to live a life where we are completely dependent upon Him so that He might fill us. And you know what's amazing? Not only were they taken for teaching and turned over for trial, but we find that Simon Peter and John are about to turn the tables. And really, God gives them a softball pitch. What's amazing is He'll take the words of the religious leaders and they're going to open the door so that basically the apostles can come in and preach. Because think of the question that they get asked. When they stand before, out of all the things that these men could have said to them, they start with this statement which opened the door for them to turn the tables on them, because they said, by whose name and in whose power was this healing done? Can't you see Simon, Peter, and John kind of drooling at the chance to answer that question? Can't you see them grinning, not able to believe that of all the things that they could have possibly said to them at the beginning of the trial, why don't you tell us about Jesus? Don't you see that's what they basically asked? What they thought was going to stop them was just like a slow softball pitch, and they're about to nail it. Because Simon Peter's like, oh, great, no problem. You'd like to know? Then let me tell you. And look at his words. Look how he turns the table. Because basically he says, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers, elders of the people, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ, you want to know who it is? No problem. Jesus Christ. Jesus, God is salvation. Yahweh, our salvation. Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah. That Jesus, oh, by the way, the Nazarene, whom you crucified. That's who did it. That's the power. That's the name. If you want to know, he looks at him. I mean, look at his words. He turns the tables. He says, are we on trial today for a benefit done to a sick man? He's saying, you've brought us here. You've arrested us. You put us in jail all night. Why? Because someone was healed? We went through all this because we showed kindness to a man and he was healed. He'd never walked, but now he's walking and praising Jesus. And that was wrong? And he says, no, let me tell you what's wrong. That man was healed by the power and name of Jesus Christ. The Nazarene, the man that you crucified. Boy, don't you know? I mean, that was the right. I mean, he's basically, that's a slap to the face of Annas and Caiaphas. That's a slap to the face of the Pharisees who were in the Sanhedrin. Because these are the men that literally had him crucified. And to the Sadducees, look at what else he says. Not only does he say that he was crucified, but he goes on, whom God raised from the dead. You had him crucified, but you know what God did? God raised him up, and now he just slapped the Sadducees in the face. You think there's no resurrection from the dead? Explain Jesus. You can't refute it. You can't deny it. There's plenty of evidence and plenty of eyewitnesses, and you know that it's true. And the same man, he has the power to heal when he was alive, and now the power is in us. And we told this man to get up and walk, and guess what? He did, because you thought you killed Jesus, but you didn't. He rose from the dead, and now he lives in us. He turned the tables, didn't he? I mean, oh my, I would have paid to have been there. Could you imagine? I imagine smoke must have been coming out of the ears of these men. He said, by this name, this man stands here in good health. But listen, then he goes one step further. And he said, he is the stone, which he basically is quoting from Psalm 118. He says, he, Jesus, this Jesus that you crucified that was raised from the dead, he was the stone that you rejected. But now, he is the chief cornerstone. He is the piece to the puzzle that nothing else stands without it. The capstone. The cornerstone. He turned the tables. They thought they were indicting him. He indicted them. And now he's about to tell them the truth. The fourth thing is he boldly tells the truth. And this is the knockout punch. He said, you asked me about the name and you asked me about the power. In verse 12, look what he says. Oh, and by the way, you rejected him, and the one that you rejected, there is no salvation except by his name. There's no way for you to be saved from your sins except by the name of Jesus. There is salvation, listen to his words, in no one else. Not in Buddha, not in Muhammad, not in yourself, in your own good works. If a man is ever going to be saved, you know what he says? He's going to be saved through Jesus Christ. Because there is no other name by which man must be saved. He boldly told these men what they didn't want to hear. There's no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which he must be saved. Do we have the same courage today to stand boldly and to tell the world the truth? It's this message that the world is dying to hear. It's this message that we have to stand and boldly proclaim in a world that is growing more hostile by the minute. Do we have the courage to stand among men and to fear God more than we fear men and to stand and tell the truth? There is no salvation except in Jesus the Christ. Folks, it's the calling that's been placed on us. As Kevin comes this morning, I want you to ask yourself the question this morning. Do you have the boldness and courage of a Spirit-filled believer? Because that's what made the difference as these men stood before the Sanhedrin. And literally, we could look and say these men had control of their lives. Well, Jesus kind of answered that and said, no, not really. Any authority you have, you only get it from one place, God, right? God ultimately reigns, and God ultimately has authority. There's nothing that man can do to you unless God allows it. Ultimately, he's the one. Do you have the courage to put your life in God's hand? Because that's what we're talking about. You have to put your life in his hand and say, I trust you with it. And if you want to use me as a vessel that will suffer, then Jesus Christ, I will suffer for your name's sake. I want to be a vessel, God, that you can use no matter what the consequence to me. You say, well, how could God ask that? Because God took on flesh and dwelt among us and went to a cross that we might be saved. How do we think we won't suffer for proclaiming the truth? They hated him, they'll hate us. They persecuted him, they'll persecute us. How can we avoid it? The question is, are we avoiding it? Because if we keep our mouth shut, that's the surest way to avoid persecution and suffering and struggle. That's the best way to keep our power intact. The best way to keep our money intact. The best way to keep the life we want to live intact. It's a dangerous thing to put your life in the hand of God and allow Him to use you to speak boldly the truth that might lead to persecution. And some of you are here today and you need Christ. Just as sure as this man needed salvation, he was destitute without God. He was hopeless without God. Some of you sit here today and you are just as hopeless and helpless without Him. And I beg of you to consider that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, the perfect Son who came and lived a perfect life, the life that you didn't live, that I didn't live, the perfect life that never disobeyed God. And when He went to the cross, He died an innocent man. The only reason He died that day was so that our sins would be placed on Him. And He could pay the price for our wrong. He could pay the price for our sin. He died our death. He took our punishment. He didn't deserve it. He took ours for us. And He laid down His life. But He said in 3 days He would pick it up again. And you better believe He came out of that grave. And Jesus is alive today in heaven. I'm going to stand and I'm going to see Him face to face again. Will you? And will you be one of His? Today you can have salvation. There was a young man that says that he went to a prayer meeting, went to a revival, and he said he was a troubled young man, and he went to this gospel meeting. His conscience was convicting him. The Spirit was moving within him, and he felt that he ought to come to Christ, but he thought to himself, some other time than tonight. Some of you, that's exactly where you are. You keep putting off the God who is calling you. And it says as he was leaving, he observed a poster that said, "Remember, it must be Christ or hell." Do you see, that's what we're talking about today. It must be Christ or hell. He said, to neglect the one is to choose the other. I pray that today you will choose Christ. If you repent of your sins and pray, He'll forgive you. He'll cleanse you. He'll save you. You can pray right there in your seat to surrender to Him and to seek His forgiveness of your sins. He's faithful to any who call. You say, well, there must be another way to be saved. There is salvation in no one else, only Jesus. Father, prick our hearts today. Speak to us. Lord, if there's one that needs to be saved, give them the courage to pray to receive Christ right where they are, to seek Your forgiveness, to say to You that they'll follow You and they believe and trust that You paid the price for their sins. Lord, if they pray that prayer where they are, give them the courage to step out into this aisle today and to come to Me and tell the church that they have accepted You as Lord and Savior. Lord, really, the truth is You will have accepted them as a child, even though they are Your enemy at this moment. You will forgive them and free them and adopt them. So, Father, I pray that we might see someone come to life today. Give us, Your church, the courage. Commit us today to share You. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, let's stand.